So let me begin with, I guess, a bit of motivation. And what I'd like to do is start with an example, two examples of algorithms, very simple algorithms. And one of them is going to be an algorithm for factoring a positive integer. And the other one is going to be for computing the GCD between two integers. So here's the factoring algorithm. It's very, very simple. It's essentially, it's just searching for a factor. You input some number n. You'd like to output, let's say, the smallest non-trivial factor of n. Or if n equals 1, then you just output 1. Otherwise, you just start searching, and you look for something that divides n. And when you finally find it, you output it, and you stop. Eventually, you'll hit 1 because, of course, you'll get to n at some point. And if you have no other factors, then that'll be a factor. The second algorithm is for computing GCDs. And maybe you've seen this algorithm before. Maybe you haven't. If you haven't, you know, there's a first time for everything, I guess. It's arguably the oldest algorithm that's currently in use. It's Euclid's algorithm, discovered more than 2,000 years ago. And so what it does is takes two integers, n and m, and let's just assume that n is the smaller of the two. If not, then swap the two. If n happens to be 0, then you output m. Otherwise, you call this algorithm recursively. You put in n, m mod n for the first argument and n for the second, and call the algorithm recursively. And this will compute the greatest common divisor of n and m. Well, the running time for the first algorithm is really pretty terrible. Maybe it's on the order of n log squared n, say. In the worst case, n iterations of this loop. Each time through the loop, you have to take some amount of time to do the division. The GCD algorithm, on the other hand, is extremely fast, order log n times log m steps. That's not obvious that that's the case, but this algorithm has been analyzed very carefully, and that's known to be the running time. So let's say that you try these algorithms with 1,000-bit numbers. You might as well not even bother with the first algorithm, right? Because if you put in a 1,000-bit number n and you try to factor it with this algorithm, we're all going to die long before it finishes, in all likelihood. It's going to take, you know, many, many times the age of the universe, orders of magnitude times the age of the universe to finish. Even if every computer in the world were working simultaneously on this problem full time, still, it would be much, much longer than anybody has. The GCD algorithm, on the other hand, takes, you know, a fraction of a second. I mean, of course, it depends on what machine you run it on. But if I use this machine here, which has, you know, kind of a case of Windows rot, and it's, you know, it's very old, you know, I press enter, and I get the answer before I've noticed any time has elapsed for a 1,000-bit number. So it's extremely efficient. So what's the point of all this? I guess the point is that it's certainly not good enough to have an algorithm for some task. An algorithm is really only worth something if it's an efficient algorithm. And this is what, at some level, computational complexity is about. I'm getting a little bit of feedback. Does somebody have control of the volume here? I don't know if there's a way we can. If I walk this way, I feel like I'm going to get to.
The room sucks.
Put
a speaker right above you.
Okay. No, it's well, whatever. Okay, so let's try to formalize things a little bit and view computation abstractly in the following way. So let's just think of a computation or an algorithm as being some device or a box. It works in a very simple way. You take some input and you stick it into the box. Something happens and you get an output. And, well, that output could be any number of different things. Okay, we're going to assume that this is a string of bits. Everything is going to be encoded in bits. The input will be a bunch of bits. The output will be a bunch of bits. Maybe these things, these bits encode things we care about, like numbers or graphs or anything else. Well, this output here could be a lot of different things. It could be a function of x that would describe some interesting thing, like, you know, the GCD of two numbers or something like that. it might not actually be a function. It might be a random sample. There's lots of cases where you want to randomly sample from some interesting distribution that might help you to learn something. For example, maybe you're trying to integrate some function, and it would be helpful to have samples from some particular distribution relating to that function. But we're mostly going to forget about all that and just focus on the case where the output here is a single bit, just a 0 or a 1. And the reason for doing that is not because other possibilities are not interesting, but this is just a helpful way of sort of narrowing down the problem so that we can categorize different types of computations in a convenient way. Most of the time when you have some function that you care about, well, you could always think about the individual bits of that function as, you know, being instances of something like this, where you're getting a single bit. So for problems where you are interested in some function, often looking at problems where you have just a single bit of output is enough to learn about that more general problem. So I'm going to mostly focus on this case where we're talking about problems where the output is a single bit, and we're going to call these decision problems because it's basically the algorithm is making a decision, a yes or a no, a 1 or a 0. A little bit more precisely, we can formalize the type of computational problem that we're going to talk about using this terminology of promise problems. And these are just the same type of problem I just mentioned. You have an output that's supposed to be a 0 or a 1, and so you can think of the inputs as being categorized into two categories, yes inputs or no inputs. We're also going to allow the possibility that there are certain inputs you don't care about. So formally speaking, all we have is some problem, A, and there's two sets. There's a set of inputs for which the answer is supposed to be yes, or output 1, and a set of inputs where the answer is supposed to be no, or output 0. And of course, we want these sets to be disjoint. You don't want the answer to be both 0 and 1. It should be one or the other. But if you like, you can have strings that are not contained in either set. These are just sort of like don't care inputs. And there's no reason why we can't have those. So essentially, it's just a problem of distinguishing between these two sets. Here's an example, and I'll come back to this example numerous times throughout the talk. It's the graph isomorphism problem. And we can phrase it as a promise problem in the following way, and this is kind of a style that's going to be typical, and we'll see it again and again, where we first describe the input, and a lot of times this is sort of implicitly describing the don't care inputs. So in this case, our input is two simple and undirected graphs. In other words, the graphs with no multiple edges, no self-loops, no directed edges, just ordinary graphs. And the two cases of interest are the yes and no. So yes, if these two graphs are isomorphic, or in other words, you can relabel the vertices of one graph to give you exactly the same edge relations as the other graph. Or the answer could be no, which is just the case where that is not true. And we don't care about inputs where the input describes three graphs or some other object. So the don't care inputs here are the inputs that don't encode a pair of graphs. Okay, so it's very clear what it means for an algorithm to solve a promise problem. You input the input, whatever happens in here happens, and you have some output, and it should be a 1 in the yes case, a 0 in the no case. And as I said in the first slide, it's really not enough to know that such an algorithm exists. You want this algorithm to be efficient. So I don't know if it's obvious or not, but it is the case that there certainly are promise problems, decision problems, that are so inherently difficult that they simply don't have an efficient algorithm. It's not a matter of discovering one or waiting until someone discovers one. It simply doesn't exist. There are problems like this. And at some level, computational complexity is concerned with this notion of inherent difficulty. This idea that there are certain problems that are efficiently solvable, there are certain problems that are not efficiently solvable. It doesn't matter how hard you try, you will never find an algorithm to solve that problem efficiently. And then some problems in between, and trying to understand the relationships among these problems and different properties of them. Toward this goal of understanding this issue, people consider many different types of models. For example, theoretical models of computers where resources are limited in some way. Certainly, putting time restrictions on a computation is the most natural and most straightforward way of doing this. This is what we normally care about. We could also think about space constraints. How much memory does a computation use? We think about different models of computation or different sort of abilities of these machines. Deterministic machines are just sort of like ordinary computers. Each step follows logically from the previous one. We can talk about non-deterministic models, which I'll say more about later. Probabilistic models, where you use randomness to help you with the computation. And of course, quantum models, which is the topic of this summer school. We think about lots of different models, such as models that are somehow based on interactions among a bunch of machines, maybe machines having different abilities and having different goals and so on. So it's not just talking about models of computation and resource constraints, but we can think about many different types of models, try to relate these things to one another, and ultimately aim to understand this notion of computational difficulty or hardness. So there's a simple abstraction that we use when thinking about this issue, which is that we think of an efficient algorithm as being one that runs in a number of steps that's polynomial in the length of the input. So the input is some string, and that string has a particular length. And the algorithm takes some number of basic steps to run. And we think of that algorithm as being efficient if the number of steps is bounded by some fixed polynomial in the length of the input. So for example, if the input length is n, and your algorithm runs in roughly n cubed steps, then that's polynomial, so that's efficient. If it runs in time n to the 100, that's polynomial, so it's efficient. N to the 1 billion, anything where the exponent is some constant. Now, nobody in the world thinks that an n to the 1 billion algorithm is truly efficient. You try to run this on a computer, it's going to take a very, very long time. But I think what's important to understand here is that this is really just a first-order approximation, where we're trying to basically focus on the difference between problems where you have done something clever and you're making use of some interesting structure of that problem versus algorithms that are stupid and doing some sort of brute force search. For example, the GCD algorithm from the first slide, there's obviously something very clever about that. It's simple, but the first time you see it, it's not obvious that that should work. It's very clear that that algorithm is making use of some property of GCDs, that it allows for this recursive calls to this function to very quickly go down to small numbers and get your answer very quickly. Whereas the factoring algorithm is clearly very stupid. All it's doing is just searching, right? Nothing clever about that algorithm at all. So if you have an algorithm that's running in a time that's some polynomial, even if it's n to the 1 million, it must obviously be doing something clever that's avoiding this sort of brute force, exhaustive type of search that would typically give you an exponential time algorithm. So with that in mind, we can define two very basic complexity classes. The first one is called P, and this is the class of all the promise problems that can be solved in polynomial time. And here we're assuming that we're going to use a deterministic computer. So I'm referring here to a Turing machine, and I'm not going to tell you what a Turing machine is. Many of you know, some of you may not. It's just an abstract model for an ordinary computer. In contrast to those are exponential time algorithms that have running time that would look something like this, 2 to the power p of n for some polynomial. And the class of all problems that can be solved with deterministic algorithms running in this amount of time is called x for exponential time. So you can think of P as the problems where you have some algorithm to solve that problem, and that algorithm is doing something clever, making some use of some interesting structure of that problem. Whereas in general, in the worst case, a problem that's in exp doesn't necessarily have any special property. It's just a problem you could solve with some kind of brute force search. These are sort of very informal ways of speaking, but that's a rough idea. Well, I have some fantastic news to tell you. These classes are not equal. You can, in fact, do more in exponential time than you can in polynomial time. And this has been known for a long time, since the 60s. But it's, I don't know, maybe the first time you see it, I wouldn't say that the proof is terribly difficult, but it's not at all obvious how you prove that fact. And the way that you don't prove it, or the way that nobody can prove it, is to pick a particular interesting problem show that there exists an exponential time algorithm for it, and then show that there isn't a polynomial time algorithm for it. It doesn't work that way. People can't come up with examples like that. The way this is proved is using a diagonalization type of argument, the same type of argument where you show that there are uncountably many real numbers. So effectively, you construct a problem that can't be solved in polynomial time because, in a way, that problem has sort of been designed to rule out every single polynomial time algorithm from working. You won't end up getting a natural problem that makes, you know, that anybody in the world really cares about. I should say that there are ways of coming up with problems that people do care about and arguing that they take exponential time, that require exponential time, but these are not simple arguments. Okay. So let me give you a few more complexity classes. These are all classical things for the moment. The point here is that I'm trying to sort of give you kind of a setting in which we can put quantum things and compare them with classical things. So I mentioned before that it's interesting to think about algorithms that make use of randomness. And if we do that, then we can define complexity classes that are based on this notion of randomness. And here are two examples. The first one is called BPP, and it stands for bounded error probabilistic polynomial time. And these are promise problems for which you have some algorithm, and it uses, say, a random number generator. And the algorithm will be correct with some probability, let's say 2/3. Then the point is that 2/3 is a large enough probability that you can gather some, you know, good statistical evidence for the correct answer to that problem. If you have an algorithm that gives you the right answer 2/3 of the time, just run that algorithm a million times or 100 times, sort of take the majority vote of those outcomes, and you'll be very, very likely to be correct. So there's nothing really special about this 2/3 here. It's just big enough to give you good statistical evidence. The second class is the class PP. It stands for probabilistic polynomial time, and it's a bit different from this. It's problems where you have an algorithm that will be correct a majority of the time. The probability of correctness will be always greater than a half, but you don't have any bound on how much bigger than a half the probability will be. So for example, something that would be correct with probability 1/2 plus some exponentially small quantity would give you enough information to know that the problem was in this class. It's not meant to be a class of problems that can be solved efficiently. It's just a complexity class that helps to talk about problems. And it's closely related to problems that have something to do with counting. And the last classical complexity class for a little bit is p-space. And I mentioned also before that we sometimes talk about problems models of computation where we're interested in limiting other resource constraints besides time. And in this case, we can talk about limiting the amount of space something uses. So p-space is the class of all promise problems that can be solved with a computer that runs in a polynomial amount of space. So we don't care how long it takes, but as long as the space or the memory usage is bounded by a polynomial, then that problem is in this class. So of course, P is contained in P space. In polynomial time, you can't possibly use more than a polynomial amount of space. Even if you use sort of one unit of space every time step, and you never reuse the same space twice, you'll never get past a polynomial amount of space in polynomial time. Question? Well, sometimes people talk about these classes and they're restricted to so-called languages, which are just promise problems where you are not allowed to have any don't care inputs. But maybe you're thinking about functions, or so you can also talk about function versions of these classes. And in some cases, they have very natural functional versions. In other cases, they're a little bit more complicated. In polynomial space, for example, if I'm computing some function, I should be concerned about whether the output contributes to my space usage. Sometimes you could talk about space-bounded computations where your output doesn't contribute to your space bound and cases where it does. So there are some issues, and there are issues here as well in terms of defining classes of functions. The short answer is these things do generally have sort of nice functional versions, but I'm not going to talk about any of those things. I'm just going to restrict to decision problems just to keep things simple. So here's a diagram of these classes. And this is a typical style of a diagram for relating sets. It's called a HASA diagram, I guess. And the way it works is that you have some set, and if you can go from one set to another set by going up along a line, then you have a set inclusion. So P is contained in BPP. That's pretty easy to see. Of course, if you have a deterministic polynomial time algorithm, you can think of that as a randomized polynomial time algorithm where you just didn't happen to look at the random number generator. Likewise, BPP is contained in P because if you had a randomized algorithm with bounded error, it's trivially unbounded error. You just sort of didn't make use of this extra restriction that you had. A little bit less obvious, PP is contained in P space. One way to see that is that if you had some randomized computation in polynomial space, you could afford to just go through all the possible settings of the random bits and just count through all of them and sort of keep a tally of how many were leading to one result versus the other. And as long as you reuse your space, you'll be running in polynomial space. And P space is contained in exponential time. Because if you run in a polynomial amount of space, you don't have time to go beyond exponential time. Because if you did more than exponential time, you must have hit the same configuration of your machine twice, so you must have been stuck in an infinite loop. So these are all pretty straightforward inclusions. I'll be sort of taking the same basic diagram throughout the talk and adding more classes to it. It'll start to become more interesting. It's not always going to be this linear ordering among these sets, but in this case it is. Okay, so I haven't said anything quantum yet, so I should say something quantum. To define some quantum versions of these classes or other complexity classes, we have to pick a model of computation. And the circuit model is a very good choice, and I make the assumption that you've seen the circuit model multiple times this week. So you don't necessarily need me to tell you this, but here's a picture of a quantum circuit. So I'm treating quantum circuits in a little bit more generality than they're sometimes treated. The first time you learn about quantum circuits and quantum algorithms, a lot of times you would talk about unitary circuits. You can think about more general types of circuits, for example, picking up a qubit and, you know, sort of looking at it and, you know, giving it a taste and throwing it in the garbage. I mean, that's a perfectly valid physical operation. It's not unitary for most people. But you can model these things. So I don't have anything particular in mind when I draw this diagram other than to suggest that we can think about the circuit model with these more general types of operations. So in this particular picture, we have three input qubits, x1, x2, x3. A bunch of stuff happens. It looks like this guy here, he must be the partial trace because there's only one quantum channel that sort of takes one qubit in and doesn't output anything. It's got to just throw it in the garbage. Maybe this is the preparation of some ancilla qubit or something like that, but I don't have anything specific in mind when I draw that. I just want to give an idea here. Of course, you could think about circuits in this way, and by the way, I'm always assuming these things are acyclic. You're not allowed to have any loops in them because that's sort of violating some kind of time ordering of things. It's kind of supposed to be time going from left to right, and these are just operations you're applying one after the other. So you can't go back in time in this model. Well, in principle, any general quantum operation or quantum channel could be thought of as a gate like this. But if we want to do interesting complexity theory and compare these things with other models, we need to restrict the gates that we use. And a typical universal gate set would be something like this, Toffoli-Hadamard and phase gate. Sometimes you would see different sets like, you know, controlled knot plus every one qubit gate or things like that, one qubit unitary. Nothing that I'm going to say really is specific to this particular choice of a gate set, but it's a very typical gate set to use in complexity. One of the nice things about it is that it allows you to very easily convince yourself that classical computations can be simulated with quantum computations. I'm going to throw in these two extra gates, the ancillary gate and the erasure gate. If you don't really want to think of these things as gates, you don't have to. The ancillary gate is just saying if you want to, you can get a bunch of fresh qubits to use in your computation, and nobody's going to prevent you from throwing things in the garbage when you're done. And the only reason I'm introducing these things and thinking of them as gates is because I'd like to just be able to talk about these somewhat more general quantum operations, quantum channels from some number of qubits to some other number of qubits. But if you prefer to think of these things as ancillary qubits that you started out with, and these are qubits that you leave sitting on the table, but you ignore them instead of throwing them in the garbage, you're free to do that. So as I mentioned, it's a nice gate set. It has a fault-tolerant implementation and so on. So for the sake of picking a model and using a model or having a reference model to state theorems and prove theorems, let's assume that I'm going to take this model, this gate set. Well, as I mentioned, it's a universal gate set. And that gate set, or any universal gate set by definition, allows you to approximate arbitrary quantum operations with any accuracy that you want. So this is a topological statement. It doesn't even really matter what your notion of error is, as long as it's sort of a sensible notion of accuracy, the statement holds. So you have in mind any quantum channel or operation from n qubits to m qubits. You can build it out of a circuit of those gates that I mentioned from the previous slide with as good of accuracy as you want. So you pick your accuracy, and then you can come up with the circuit that does it. Well, in general, if you have an operation that maps n qubits to m qubits, it could require an exponential number of gates. There's no way to avoid that. And that's very easy to prove that using, well, I guess it's sort of a combination of a counting argument and a measure theoretic argument. If you think about the total number of channels from n qubits to m qubits, where you just imagine sort of discretizing everything in some way, putting little epsilon balls around all these different channels, and you're trying to get within epsilon of them, there's just simply too many to possibly cover them all with some small number of circuits. You'll need lots and lots of circuits. In fact, so many that you're forced to have exponential size circuits, because every possible arrangement of gates in a polynomial size circuit will not give you enough circuits to cover all these operations. On the other hand, the number of gates you need does scale very well in terms of the accuracy. So if you have in mind some particular accuracy, epsilon, and let's imagine that we've picked a standard way of measuring accuracy that I'm not going to worry about for the sake of this talk. You can get a simulation with accuracy epsilon, and you really only need a polylog number of gates in your circuit. So if you take the log of epsilon, log of 1 over epsilon, so that's the number of bits you need to write epsilon, then you're only going to need a number of gates that's polynomial in that length. That's very good. And this is follows from the Soloveitchi-Taieff theorem. OK, so now let's define a quantum complexity class. I guess it's the most natural of all. Actually, before I do that, I should say what it means to have an algorithm, a quantum algorithm. If we're talking about the quantum circuit model and we think about a quantum algorithm for a particular problem, this is what we mean. We imagine we have a family of circuits or a set of circuits, one for each possible length of an input. So here n is ranging over all non-negative integers. You have one circuit for every possible length of input. And we're going to say that such a family like this is a polynomial time uniform family if these circuits are not very big. They all have polynomial size. The nth one is size polynomial in n. And moreover, there's an efficient way to actually describe those circuits. You have some ordinary classical polynomial time algorithm that will take as input n, and it'll run, and it'll take a polynomial number of steps in n, and it'll output for you the description of that circuit. So this is kind of what we're thinking of when we talk about a polynomial time algorithm. We're really talking about the sizes of circuits, but it's natural to think about this as a polynomial time algorithm. So not only is it a quantum algorithm that has a number of operations that's polynomial, but it's sort of controlled by an ordinary classical computer, and that classical computer doesn't take more than polynomial time to actually tell you where you're supposed to apply the gates. If you want to run this algorithm on a particular input of length n, then you just take out the nth circuit, and you prepare some state like this, and you plug it in, you let the thing run, and one qubit comes out, and you measure that qubit in the standard basis, and it tells you a 0 or a 1. And so to avoid having to sort of talk about all this stuff over and over throughout the talk, let's just agree that we're going to write Q of x to mean, you know, the output, which in general is some random output, either a 0 or 1, some distribution of outputs that would come out of such a procedure. So I guess this is the sort of natural thing you might want to write if you had some quantum algorithm that was taking polynomial time. Think of Q of x as just the random variable you get by looking at the output. So that's what I'll, when I refer to such things like this throughout the talk, that's what I mean. Okay. So now I can define the first quantum complexity class, BQP. You've probably heard it talked about this week. Well, I don't mind going out on a limb saying that it's the most important of all quantum complexity classes. I guess in the slide I wrote it as perhaps, but you know, I just want to leave a little bit of room for alternate opinions, I guess. But it's really what we care about. I mean, we want to know what kinds of problems we can solve with a quantum computer efficiently. So at least to this first order approximation of thinking about polynomial time as being efficient, this is the complexity class that we really care about in quantum computing. So here's the definition. It's just based on what I wrote in the previous slide. If you have a class of, this class is the class of all promise problems A, for which you have a polynomial time uniform family, just like the previous slide. And if you put in some input to that that algorithm, it does what you would want it to do. So if it's a yes input, you run that thing and you get an output either 0 or 1, and you would like that probability to be big. So let's say 2/3, just like we did before. And there's nothing special about this number 2/3, it's just something that's significantly larger than a half. And if you input a no input, then something similar happens for the no output. And if you input a don't care input, then we don't care. We don't place any restriction at all on what happens. So as I just said, a wide range of values could be substituted for this 2/3, exactly the same idea as before. If you have an algorithm like this and it gives you a probability 2/3 to get the correct answer, just run that algorithm over and over again, count how many times it said 0, how many times it said no, 1, and take the majority vote, and you will have an algorithm that has a very small probability of error. Okay, so the natural question to ask at this point is, how does this complexity class relate to the ones that I mentioned before? That's a very basic type of question that we're interested in quantum complexity theory. Well, it's not too hard to show that this inclusion holds. Of course, BPP is contained in BQP. If you have a randomized polynomial time algorithm, you can simulate that with a quantum polynomial time algorithm. Not quite so easy to see, but nevertheless true, is that BQP is contained in PP. So remember, what PP is, this type of probabilistic algorithm where you don't necessarily gather good statistical evidence about the answer. You just know that your algorithm is correct with probability bigger than a half. So it's kind of like if you had a room full of people like this and you randomly gave them each a problem to solve, they all sort of solve the problem, and then all at once they all shout out the answer. Half the people say yes, half the people say no. Well, you're not necessarily going to be able to tell which was right, yes or no. But if you went through and you counted each person, you could figure out what the right answer was, because the majority would be correct. Okay, well, I claim that the first inclusion is totally obvious. It's obvious if you believe what I said about the universal families of circuits and so on, that you can simulate classical circuits, because if I have an algorithm and it's a BPP algorithm, I can imagine having some physical device that implements it, a little random number generator, a bunch of Boolean circuits hooked together and so on. Well, I can just go to each one of those little things and simulate it with a quantum gate. And, you know, a classical gate, even if it's randomized, it is an example of a quantum channel. It's just a special type of quantum channel, but nevertheless, this theorem from before tells us that we can simulate it with whatever accuracy we want. And these are constant size things, and we can use this theorem, the Solovay-Cataya theorem, to make the error as small as we want. We hook them all up, the error is not going to be very big, and it's going to give us the right answer. And if you like, you can just go through sort of a simple family of classical Boolean circuits, including, you know, random bit generator, fan-out, AND gate, NOT gate, for example. Just figure out how to construct each of those things with that gate set that I showed you, and that's not very difficult to do. And you would find that in books and survey papers and so on. This other containment, BQP contained in PP, is a little bit harder to prove. There's sort of two basic ways that I know of to prove that. The first way, which was historically the first way, is kind of, I guess you could think of it as an intuitive proof. And that is that if you have these sort of unbounded error probabilistic computations where you don't require that the correct answer is significant, happens with probability significantly larger than a half, you can effectively simulate interference. You can imagine, for example, running two probabilistic computations simultaneously, and you can condition on the two of them giving you a precisely the same answer, and if they don't, then you just sort of flip a coin. You can do tricks like this, and you can prove this containment. There's another way to do it, which is a little bit more robust and useful in other settings, which is to think about a quantum computation as a matrix multiplication problem. If I wrote for you a quantum circuit, and it wasn't very big, and I asked you, what does it do? Well, the natural thing for you to do would be to just, you know, expand everything out into very large matrices and just do a bunch of matrix multiplications, right? Just for each gate, do the multiplication, and then see what you get at the end. Well, this is going to be an exponential size problem that you're working with. But it turns out that there's this abstract framework in which these PP computations can very closely simulate, at least implicitly, these exponential size matrix multiplication problems and give you some answer that's some, the probability will be some, you know, very closely related to, let's say, you know, an entry of your choice in that matrix. So here is our diagram now. We've just taken BQP and we've inserted it between the two classes, BPP and PP. I should mention that I said before that P and X are different, and that was good news. So of course, that means because P is contained here and this is contained here and so on, we know that at least one of these lines here has to be a proper subset relationship, because at the bottom here, this is a proper subset of the top one. But unfortunately, nobody knows which of these is proper. Nobody can prove that any of them is proper. We know one of them is, at least one. People conjecture that they're all proper, but nobody can prove that any one of them is a proper containment. So it could be that P space equals P, and it could be that BPP equals exp. That's just the sort of the nature of the field of computational complexity. It's extremely difficult to prove lower bounds. It's very difficult to prove relationships between models of computation where you have sort of two different resource constraints in play. You can compare a polynomial time and exponential time using diagonalization, but as soon as you throw time and space into the equation, then people just don't really know how to do it. I said people conjecture every one of these containments is proper. That's not exactly true. A lot of people conjecture that P is equal to BPP, that you should be able to come up with good pseudorandom generators that would allow you to simulate BPP computations in P, but other people think that is not true. But in any case, it's certainly not proved. What time did I start? Oh, okay. So I'm going a little bit slow. I should probably pick up the pace a little bit. But okay, so the next class that I want to mention is NP. And this is going to, again, be classical. And then I'll talk about the quantum version of this. For many problems that people are interested in, that they actually want to solve in practice, it's possible to efficiently verify that you have a solution when you have it. But it may be difficult to actually find a solution. For example, a factoring problem is easy to verify when you have a factor. You just do the division, and that can be done quickly, and you check that you have a proper factor. But it may be very difficult to find a factor. So this complexity class NP, it stands for non-deterministic polynomial time, which doesn't really matter for the purposes of this talk, is meant to formalize this idea. So here's the definition of the class NP. So we'll say a promise problem is in NP if there exists a couple of things. One is a polynomial, and the second is an algorithm, V. And there should be two properties that are satisfied. So this algorithm V is going to take two inputs. It's going to take one input, which is the input to your problem, and it's going to take another input string, Y. And you think of Y as being a proof. So you require two things of this algorithm. The first is that if you have a yes input to your problem, then it should be possible for somebody to prove to you that the input is indeed yes. So more precisely, there should exist some string Y, some proof string. And the length of the string is always equal to P of X. That's what this P is about here. It's just telling you you can't have the string be too long. So that if you put the two strings into your algorithm, you're going to get a 1 as an output. And you think of that output as saying, OK, I've verified your proof. Your proof has convinced me that The answer to the problem is yes. For example, if X was encoding this number n, and you wanted to know, does this number n have a prime factor that's less than some threshold, then Y could encode for you, you know, an example of a factor, and you could check it. But you can think of these things much more generally. The sort of complementary condition here is this one here. It says that if the answer is no, then you're not going to be convinced just that the answer is yes. So it doesn't matter what proof string you try to stick into this computation, it's always going to say no. So we think of this V, this algorithm V, which V is for verification. Think of it as just like yourself when you're reading a paper, and X is the statement of some theorem, and you want to be convinced that the theorem is true. Well, you know, Y is kind of the contents of the paper, and you read it, and if you believe the theorem, then you say, yes, I believe it. And then you know the theorem must be true. Okay, well, imagining an idealized setting here where nobody's making any mistakes. But if the theorem is false, so that's kind of like a no input here, it doesn't matter how clever somebody is, whatever they try to do to convince you, whatever proof they write down, you're not going to buy it. Because, you know, in this sort of idealized world where nobody makes a mistake, there's not going to be a proof of a false theorem. So these terms, completeness and soundness, are coming from logic, and you think of completeness as meaning that true statements can be proved, and soundness means that false statements cannot be proved. So that's what this notion is capturing. So we can go back to our example of the graph isomorphism problem, and it's an example of a problem that's in NP. So remember, this is how it's stated. Your input is two graphs. You're supposed to say yes when the two graphs are isomorphic and no when they're not isomorphic. So it's certainly a problem that's in NP. And one way to argue that is to take this proof string Y from the definition on the previous slide and interpret that string as a description of an isomorphism. You're just asking, does there exist an isomorphism? Your proof can be the isomorphism. And this will be the pattern for many problems that are stated as existential questions. You know, does there exist such and such a thing? A lot of times this proof string can just simply be a description of that thing. So for example, here's two graphs. They are isomorphic. Well, nobody knows how to efficiently decide in polynomial time whether or not two graphs are isomorphic. Of course, when the number of vertices is 7, you can do it, and just by exhaustively searching through all the possibilities, it won't take you that long. But if it was 7,000 vertices instead of 7, it might take a lot longer. But it's very easy for me to convince you that the two graphs are isomorphic. I can just write down an isomorphism for you. So here's an isomorphism, and if you go to the first graph and you just sort of replace each of the labels according to this isomorphism, then you will see that exactly the same edge relations exist in the first graph as in the second graph. For example, see vertex 2 here is connected to 7, 3, and 5. So here 2 is connected to 7, 3, and 5, so it works. And if you went through all the possibilities, you would see that it works. And there's only a quadratic number of possibilities to check. So that would be an efficient algorithm to test that this is really a good isomorphism. Now there's something important to notice about this class, which is that there's sort of an asymmetry between yes and no. Let's imagine that we just took our problem from before and we just swapped the yes inputs and the no inputs. We can do that. So if we do that with our graph isomorphism problem, we get a new problem. It's called the graph non-isomorphism problem. In some sense, from the point of view of just computing the answer on a computer, there's really not much of a difference. Right? If you could do one, you can do the other. You just flip the answer. But from the point of view of, you know, this complexity class NP and related notions, there is a big difference. So here, the yes case is when the two graphs are not isomorphic. No case is where they are isomorphic. So for example, let's say the input are these two graphs. The correct answer is yes, they are not isomorphic. But let's suppose that I want to prove to you that those two graphs are not isomorphic. How do I do that? I can tell you, well, look, I tried all the combinations. Trust me. I could have said the same thing about the two graphs from the previous slide, right? That would not be a sound proof, because I would be able to convince you of a false statement. Well, I don't want to discourage you from thinking about the problem, but I can tell you that nobody knows how to do it. It's not known if this graph non-isomorphism problem is in NP or is an NP or not. Nobody knows a way to to write down a proof that's polynomial time verifiable that two graphs are not isomorphic. In this particular case, I can do it. For example, if we go to this first graph and I say, okay, well, look at this edge between 2 and 6 here. If I remove that edge between 2 and 6, I'm going to get two disconnected components. I'm basically going to get a triangle here and a square here. And now I go over here and you can check for yourself that go one by one through all the edges. Remove an edge, you will not get two disconnected components. And that's enough to convince yourself that the two graphs can't possibly be isomorphic. Because this, you know, removing an edge and getting two connected components, that's disconnected components, that's a property that's invariant under permuting the graph. So surely they can't be isomorphic. But if I gave you two different graphs that have 7,000 vertices each, that property may not work anymore. Maybe you come up with a different property, maybe that one will work. But the point is that nobody can find a single property that always works. Okay, I think this is the last classical complexity class. I just want to mention very briefly, I'm running out of time. You can also think of a version of NP where the verification is a probabilistic verification. And then the class that we get is called MA. So it's exactly the same as before. Everything here is the same as NP. The only difference is that our algorithm V here is a probabilistic algorithm, and we don't require that it's correct all the time. It's just correct with high probability. So it's kind of like a probabilistic verification of a proof. MA stands for Merlin Arthur. It's just you know, the characters from the story that have this kind of relationship. Arthur is a sort of a rational person, and he just wants the answer, and he can flip a coin. He uses randomness, and Merlin is very selfish and very intelligent, but he sort of, you know, can't trust him. So Arthur wants to have Merlin convince him of something, and Arthur is willing to use a probabilistic algorithm to verify it, but you know, he's not going to be convinced if Merlin is not telling the truth. And there are other sort of variants in this framework of so-called Arthur-Merlin games, and this is just one of the classes. So that's the explanation for the name. Okay, so now here's our diagram. We have NP here and MA here. Of course, NP is contained in MA, that's trivial. MA is contained in PP, that's not trivial at all, but using this sort of business about, you know, thinking about matrix multiplication in exponential size, among exponential size matrices and so on, this can be proved. BPP is trivially contained in MA, P is trivially contained in NP. It's worth noting here that there's no relationship known between NP and BQP. NP has all these interesting problems that we really care about in practice, hundreds of them. We would love to be able to solve those problems in BQP. That would give, you know, even further motivation for building a quantum computer. But we don't have any relationship between those two that we can prove. Most people, I think, would conjecture that the two are incomparable. There will definitely be problems that are in NP that are not in BQP, and conversely, there will be problems here that won't be over here either. But nobody has proved that yet. And we can't hope to prove such a separation before we prove that P is not equal to P space, for example. So we don't expect to be able to prove, to show these are incomparable. Okay, so now let me talk about QMA, which is a quantum version of NP. There's more than one way to go about trying to define quantum versions of these classes. But here's one way. So it's a quantum version of NP, but really I suppose it's quantum version of MA because a quantum algorithm is really only going to be interesting when it's probabilistic. Sort of exact quantum algorithms are not very well motivated from a physical point of view. So we're going to change the definition in two ways. One is that, of course, we're going to allow the verification procedure to be quantum. And the second is that this proof string is now going to be replaced by a quantum state. So we can imagine having a quantum proof that tries to prove some particular fact. And if we do this, then we come up with this definition, this quantum complexity class QMA. So a promised problem A is in QMA if and only if there's two things that are just like before, this polynomial P, just telling us how long the proof is going to be, how many qubits. And the second thing is an algorithm, which is just like the verification procedure from before, but now it's quantum. And two properties have to be satisfied. They're exactly the same as they were before, except we've modified them in the ways I've indicated here. If we have a yes input, that means somebody should be able to prove to us that the answer is really yes. And the way they prove it is they give us some quantum state on P of x qubits. We plug the input x along with the quantum state rho into our algorithm, we run it, and it should output a 1 with high probability, as long as this person has chosen a good proof. On the other hand, if the answer is no, then it doesn't matter what somebody puts into our computer. Whatever quantum state they want is not going to convince us that the answer is really yes, except for some small probability. And just as before, we can reduce the errors here. Sort of implicitly, the error is 1/3, but you can make this be very, very small if you like. And I'll say that very quickly because I'm running out of time. You would expect to be able to reduce this error by doing the same kind of argument where you just sort of amplify by running something multiple times and gathering statistical evidence. But there's something kind of special happens here, which is that, in fact, you can even do this, but you don't need a fresh copy of the quantum proof every time. You can use the same proof over and over, as long as the person who gave it to you was very careful and gave you a good proof. So if you had a verification that gave you the same kind of behavior as before, then for any polynomial q of your choice, you can come up with some new polynomial time quantum algorithm that's going to have the same sort of properties as you had before, except now this error is going to shrink to this exponentially small quantity. And that's kind of nice because if you want, you can take this q here to be larger than p. So you can make your error be smaller than the reciprocal of the dimension of your Hilbert space, which happens to be a useful fact for proving things about these classes. One of the things that fact can be used to do is to prove that QMA is contained in PP. You can imagine taking a verification procedure that showed you some problem was in QMA. Just reduce the error until you're blue in the face. Make it very, very small, much, much smaller than the reciprocal of the dimension of the Hilbert space. And now imagine just throwing in a completely random state instead of a proof. Well, if you think about it a little bit and do some calculations, you'll see that what you'll end up with is an algorithm. And it won't necessarily give you a very good, it won't be a very good algorithm, but it'll give you some tiny little amount of information about the correct answer, and it's enough to show that QMA is contained in PP using exactly the same argument as BQP contained in PP. So here's where this class lies. And maybe I'll take this to be the last slide. It's going to be a natural breaking point, I think. I didn't say very much about NP-complete problems when I talked about NP. I didn't say anything, I think. But there are hundreds and hundreds of examples of problems that are so-called NP-complete problems, which are, in a certain formal sense, the hardest problems that are in the class NP. And we can think of these as sort of being the most general types of search problems that we can solve, that we can verify in the sense of the definition of NP. There's a lot of interesting problems there. And at least to some extent, somewhat limited extent, but nevertheless, to some extent, we can do the same kind of thing with this class QMA and come up with examples of QMA complete problems, which are in some sense the hardest problems in QMA. And here's one of the best known examples of such a problem. It's called the two local Hamiltonian problem. So here the input to the problem is a description of a Hamiltonian on n qubits, and we assume that each of the terms in the Hamiltonian is acting on just two qubits at a time. And we assume that we're also given two rational numbers that are not too close to each other. And all we're trying to do is decide how large the energy is for the ground state of this Hamiltonian. So let's say the S inputs are those for which there exists some state, which we could take to be the ground state, for which the energy is going to be lower than A. And the no inputs are such that it doesn't matter what you put in here, this thing is always going to be larger than B, so the ground state energy is going to be higher than B. And we're not worried about cases where A and B are so close together that the problem is getting some kind of unnatural difficulty from some property of real numbers or something like that. We're interested in a case where there's a big separation between the two. So this is a natural problem to think about, and it turns out to be a QMA complete problem. And if you like, you can think about this as a sort of quantum version of the Cook-Levin theorem. The Cook-Levin theorem is famous and important theorem from complexity theory that essentially gives you the first interesting NP-complete problem. And that's three satisfiability. And the way it works for establishing that all these different problems are NP-complete is to sort of start with this one problem, three set, and then kind of work from there and sort of branch out. And then by now, people have done this for thousands of problems. So this is kind of a similar spirit here. The proof at some intuitive level has some similarities to that proof. And I won't say anything more about that, and I'm sure that some people would be disappointed, but there is this really interesting area of study that looks into problems of this nature. It's called Hamiltonian complexity, where you think about the relationships between quantum computational complexity and properties of physical systems, such as ground states of Hamiltonians of this form, lots of other properties of such things, and it's a very active area of research, and many people are thinking about it. This is not the only area within complexity theory that I'm not going to mention, but it is one. Of course, I don't have time in just a couple of lectures to be exhaustive about everything. And I think that I'm probably out of time, so I shouldn't go to the next topic, which is, well, it's I am going to give you an example of a problem that's in QMA that's not known to be in MA, to at least give you an intuitive feel for what the power of a quantum proof could possibly be, how you could use that. But that's going to take me more than a minute or so I'll put that off until tomorrow morning, and I'll stop here for the day.